Bless the beast and the children, for in this world they have no voice, they have no choice.
We had a little girl come in one time, and her abuse had been so severe she had quit talking to humans. And when she came in, all she did was sit and she cried. And after about two or three weeks of trying so hard to get her to communicate and be part of the family, we were just like, we said, Lord, we don't know how to help her. You're gonna have to do a miracle. She was outside and this baby deer come walking up to her.
The deer wouldn't stop. It just kept licking her and kissing on her. And it was really the first time I ever saw her smile.
And then after that, the deer needed her, and she had to rehab this deer. So that gave her purpose. And then later she grew up, a couple years later she got adopted, and now she lives in a great adoptive home and has her own family.
The children who come to us all come through the Department of Family and Children's Services. They've all been traumatized. Some of them have been abused sexually, emotionally, physically. Some of them have been abandoned. Many of them have been neglected. And so they come to us very wounded.
Many times they never had an adult tell them that they care and that they are concerned about their future and where they're going.
With the children, no matter what happens before they get here, it's love the moment they walk in the door.
We take them to the professionals and we push until we find out what is wrong and we get them the help that they need.
But through the love of God and the animals and the staff and everybody, we saturate them with love and treat them just like they're part of our family. We don't treat them any different.
And Noah's Ark is indeed a safe place. It is their ark in a flood.
So when a child comes into Noah's Ark that's been abused, most of the times they do not trust humans at all.
Usually they're pretty scared of us, and they don't want to be here. And the first thing we introduce them to is the animals. We usually take them up to the natural habitat and let them visit all the tigers and bears and the monkeys. And so then they're softened up a little bit. Then they go down to the rehab center and see the more vulnerable animals, the baby animals that are being fed on bottle, and some of the little crippled animals that are being, you know, nurtured back to health.
Many of our children know nothing about nurturing. They've never been nurtured. They've never been cared for.
But they can look at a little kitten or a baby deer or a puppy who's also been hurt. And the children can begin to give love to an animal that needs it.
The process of healing in the child begins instantly.
And once they begin to give love to something else, they can begin to give love to themselves, which is so vitally important for their health and growth.
And we find that a lot here with our children, with their emotional needs. The animals, a lot of times, are their counselors.
Animals can bring a certain amount of joy and peace to people where we may not be able to with our words.
It's just phenomenal what happens. You actually see miracles every day with the children.
We have so many different animals that come in, a variety of wildlife that are indigenous to Georgia.
Could be a deer hit by the side of the road and just had a baby, and the mother, you know, and the baby come in, or the mother didn't make it and just the baby comes in and we bottle raise it.
Then we go through a process called hacking out after we get them to that level. And that process just helps them learn how to forage for food for themselves in their natural environment. And then that animal we go through a release process.
And then sometimes baby birds, when there's a storm, gets blown out of their nest, and squirrels and things such as this.
At this time we have 10 baby possums that we've been feeding for the last month, and we just had two or three brought in today.
It's sometimes a challenge. We get alligators in and different snakes and a lot of birds of prey, and we just mend them back and try to turn them back loose into the wild.
Well, this is our newest member of Noah's Ark. He's about 3 months old now, and his name is Bagheera. He is a black leopard. He should blacken on out once he gets a little bit older.
Here at Noah's Ark, we do have 250 acres, and we have 900 to 1,000 animals here at our facility.
At this point, Noah's Ark has taken in a lot of exotic wild animals that cannot be released.
They mainly come in through the Department of Natural Resources.
Lions, tigers, bears, so forth, monkeys, wolves.
They were brought in either injured. Some of them no longer had a home, so we have to make sure we have the space for them and the habitats. They come here and live the rest of their life. Sometimes individuals will bring animals to us, and because they either get too big or they start biting. When they come here, they like being here, and they like the people and the children.
We got a bear, tiger, and lion that came in, which would been, they're going on 4 years now. I still hand feed them. The children got to name them. They named Blue, Shirkan, and Leo the lion. The tiger, if I don't mess with him at least 15, 20 minutes a day, he comes out, and you can just hear him crying. I mean, he just comes up there, and it's just a big old purr, I guess you might say, like a kitten.
People call all the time and say, you know, well, what is the charge? How much does it cost? And there's never a charge at Noah's Ark.
It's because at 5 years old, she made a commitment to God. She said, and I will not charge anybody to see my animals.
A lot of people come out and visit us, and it is a beautiful place.
If you want to see the animals, we'll take you on a tour. Come in, talk with us.
They come from Africa. We have two baboons, and we have one snow macaque in there. The largest baboon, his name is C3.
We're able to help educate them a little more. We're able to tell them about those animals and their natural habitat.
A lot of times you'll hear them say that they just feel like a peace coming over them when they see all the animals and all the different breeds living in one place together.
You won't find a place like this anywhere else. We're one of a kind.
The caregivers here are extremely devoted, extremely loving, extremely open to learning about children and ways of working with them.
Each one of them are equally as important, and I could do none of this without them.
To be part of Noah's Ark is to be a member of a very special family, to belong, to really belong.
You feel like you're making a difference in the world.
Just a lot of love. I mean, it just regardless whether you're working with the children or the animals, it's just love.
We have foster children, yes, but they're more our family than just foster kids.
To be part of that and to really realize that you don't have to be born into a family, but you can become part of one.
This is one way of passing on all the wonderful things that I've received in my lifetime. And it's payback time.
What I really enjoy more than just anything is watching the children take apart.
Just seeing them change, that means so much.
Each one of us feel like that it's our ministry.
It's a rewarding place.
It's everything to me.
Noah's Ark started with a dream. A young lady, Jama Hitchcock, who decided that she wanted to make a difference.
The dream is to be there for the children and to be there for the animals and to give them a family and to give them hope and give them love that they'd never had. And every day, we have anywhere from 20 to 30 to 40 animals coming in, from wildlife to exotic animals. And every day we get several calls on children, and we only have room for 24.
We do have blueprints for a children's care home that would house up to 400 children.
And then build a home for the terminally ill infants and for mothers to have their babies, and then either to teach them parenting skills or to adopt them out. And then we'll also have a home for the elderly, which is very much needed because they offer the largest amount of wisdom that we need in order to take care of the children. We have all of our dreams written down and what we want to do and what it will cost.
But the hardest thing is when people call and there's no place for a child to go and there's no place for an animal to go. And it's like the end of the rope. The child's going to be hospitalized in a mental ward or taken to YDC, or the animal's going to be euthanized, and I have to say no.
Well, one day, I hope that I never have to say no, and we'll have a large enough facility, and we'll have enough staff, so when we get the calls, we can say, bring them on, and we have a place to put them.
The children.